Good afternoon, and thank you for joining me today as we explore a world of zarzuela. The very famous Plácido Domingo himself grew up hearing, singing, and performing zarzuela music from his very own famous parents who were touring zarzuela performers. In 1949, both Plácido's mother and father toured in Moreno Toroba's zarzuela company. It was so successful that both his parents decided to stay in Mexico to open a zarzuela company of their own. It was Plácido Domingo, along with some of his colleagues, who began to shine a light to this beautiful art of music. However, outside of Spain and Latin America, little is known about this popular Spanish opera. So, what is zarzuela? According to Christopher Weber, it has been said that zarzuela means to Spain what operetta means to Vienna, Offenbach to Paris, Gilbert and Sullivan to London, and the musical to Broadway. It is a Spanish lyric drama that alternates between spoken and sung scenes. As the story goes, in 1657, at the royal palace of El Prado near Madrid, King Philip IV of Spain and Queen Marina attended their first zarzuela. It was a comedy by Pedro Calderón de la Barca, set to music by Juan de Hidalgo. This new style became known as La Zarzuela. It was named after King Philip's hunting lodge that was located in the countryside. There are two main types of zarzuelas, the earliest, which is the Baroque, and then the Romantic. These two can be divided into two main subgenres, the Genérico Grande, which is three acts, and the Genérico Chico, which is one act. Because of its great popularity, zarzuela spread to many Spanish and Hispanic countries and can even be found as far as the Philippines. Zarzuela did well to incorporate dances, choruses, solos, and ensemble numbers to orchestral accompaniment. Much of the plots of Baroque zarzuelas are filled with mythical creatures to comedic characters, and like many other opera forms, zarzuela sometimes has spoken interludes in verses. In the 18th century, the artistic style of music that dominated the stage was that of the Italian opera. Zarzuela was like much of the 18th and 19th century Italian opera in that the voices were not categorized by our very own customary rule of thumb divisions. Like it is custom in Italian opera, Spanish music was also tailored to specific singers and their individual strengths. The increase in popularity of Italian opera, however, forced zarzuela to fall out of fashion. But it became a Spanish tradition, and it took on smaller roles known as the tornadilla, which is the Italian equivalent to the intermezzo. The better part of zarzuela, known as the Golden Age, lasted from about 1850 to 1950, where over 10,000 zarzuelas were written in Spain alone. It brought on the birth of romantic zarzuela with the help of young writers like Ventura de la Vega and Luis de Olona, together with leading composers like Francisco Barbieri and Joaquín Cazimbe. Both writers and composers opened the Madrid Teatro de Cinco. Later, their work led to them building the Teatro de la Zarzuela in Calle Jóvenes. This horseshoe auditorium dedicated to lyric theater in Spain in Spanish language remains the temple of zarzuela even today. These young writers modeled their plays from the French, which were also known as the zarzuela grande. Much of the music composed by Barbieri was very similar to that of the Italian opera, and it took him even 13 years before he was confident enough to incorporate Spanish plots in music. The zarzuela you will hear this afternoon come from a variety of one, two, and three acts from the Genérico Grande, which is the three acts, and the Genérico Chico, the one act, each with plots ranging from romance to comedy and even tragedy. My first selection today comes from Francisco Anseco Barbieri, born on August 3, 1823 in Madrid. In 1837, Barbieri attended the Madrid Conservatory, studying clarinet, piano, voice, and composition. Barbieri's biggest masterpiece is that of comedy El Barbarío de Lavapiés, The Little Barber of Lavapiés, which has been deemed the best known zarzuela today. It is a zarzuela grande in three acts with libretto by Luis Marina de Lara. It premiered in Madrid in the Teatro de la Zarzuela on December 19, 1874. In Act One, a crowd has gathered to celebrate the fiesta of St. Augustine. The barber, Lamparilla, comes out singing to the crowd about his glorious career. But before he can crack a joke about even the government, there's a crisis on the street. And so the chief minister, Grambilde, orders the night patrols to dampen the troubles. Then the seamstress Paloma, who has captured the heart of La Maria, enters and sings a song, Coma si en la calle de la Paloma, which teases and flirts with La Maria. Conservatory, where he studied a variety of disciplines. Among his best known works is El Dúo de la Africana, the duet from La Africana, a zarzuela in one act, libretto by Manuel Erguerici, It premiered in the Madrid Teatro Apollo on May 18, 1893. In scene one, inside the rehearsal room of the theater, we have the manager, Cherubino, who comes in to greet the chorus for their morning rehearsals, but has great trouble trying to rile them up and get their attention. So he doesn't really care, and he goes on and does his business for the day, which is his prerogative to see how much money he's going to be making that night. But the good news is that his wife, Antonielli, his daughter Maria, and a tenor, Giuseppini, have all agreed to perform for free, helping him cut down the cost of the production. However, there's some sneaking around going on. And the tenor, Giuseppini, is in love with his wife, Antonielli. And the daughter catches them flirting and throwing kisses to each other, so she makes her father aware of what is going on. But the bass of the production is also infatuated with the daughter, but she wants nothing to do with him. So Cherubini gets this idea that to keep the wife in order and to make sure that the daughter doesn't get a bad name, he offers his daughter to Giuseppini. But he refuses, saying that if I marry her, this is gonna ruin my career and it's gonna ruin my voice. So, Giuseppini then tries to convince Antonielli to elope with him. But although it sounds like a great idea, she refuses his plea. In el dúo comprende lo grave de mi situación. After, Giuseppini sings a passionate song called Jota, No cantes más la africana, to Antonielli as a last attempt in hopes that maybe she will change his mind and run away with him, but she still refuses him. Singing the part of Giuseppini, please help me welcome my friend, tenor Mario Luis.
Thank you. mia, te dire mi cielo, te dire un canto del mio cielo, cantare tu boca, cantare tu manos, cantare tu ojos, cantare tu garbo, hay armonia mia, mi solo amor, si mi quieres dillo por favor.
Ay, amor, Dios, que me mata,
aperta de vida de mi corazón,
de la de mi compasión,
eres tu mi vida, eres mi ilusión,
siente por fin de mi lado,
eres mi ilusión,
serás mi
ilusión.
Geronimo Gimenez, born in Seville on October 10, 1854, began his musical studies at a young age with his father and Salvador Vinagre in Cadiz. At the age of 20, he received a scholarship to the Paris Conservatory, where he won first prize for harmony and counterpoint, and also won the piano prize from the leading pianist, Claude Debussy. In 1885, he became the conductor in the Teatro Apollo, and then later at the famous Rialto de la Zarzuela. La Tempranica is considered to be Jimenez's masterpiece, a zarzuela in one act with libretto by Julian Romea. It premiered at the Teatro de la Zarzuela on September 19, 1900. In scene one, Don Luis, who is a wealthy landlord, is in the countryside near Granada with his friends rejoicing after their hunting games. The Englishman, Mr. James, tries to amuse his crowd of friends with his attempt at speaking Castellano. And like every tourist, Mr. James wants to hear some of the typical songs or canciones of Spain. To meet the request of Mr. James, Don Luis sends his servant to find the gypsy Gambia. When Gambia arrives, he and his whole family greet Don Luis as if they know each other well. And by the looks of Maria, Gambia's sister, Mr. James thinks that there might be a love affair. Don Luis, not liking the attention, quickly orders Gambia to sing him a song. So Gambia quickly follows orders and begins to sing a zapateo, La Tarantula en un bicho muy malo, a song of the wicked ways of the tarantula, or perhaps the dangers of falling in love.
Ni rayos ni balas, y le tengo otra cosa más mala. Thank you.
su hija Valencia on October 14, 1873. The son of the town's conductor, at the age of 16, he left his hometown to study at the conservatory with Salvador Giner, where he acquired all the techniques to become a successful zarzuela composer. In 1893, he took a scholarship to the conservatory in Madrid, only to come back home at his dislike of the treatment of the art of music. After waiting 5 years, he takes a job that would allow him to compete with the famous Caballero. In 1900, he was offered the libretto of El Motete, the motet, by the famous Alvarez Quintero brothers. It was with this libretto that his work took notice, allowing Serrano to become one of the leading composers in zarzuela. However, like all composers, some of his compositions never take notice. Like that of the zarzuela, El Trust de los Teneros, The Trust of the Lovelaces, libretto by Carlos Sanchez and Enrique Garcia Alvarez. It is a zarzuela in one act, which premiered at the Teatro de Apolo on December 3rd, 1910. El Trust de los Teneros has a loose and wacky plot about a group of rich men who travel the world in search of adventure. El Trust de la Zarzuela is a high name of society goers. Don Juan, a member of the society, tells the wife of the president that if he is to continue to fund the art that she so desperately loves, he needs to woo the most attractive woman. However, the plot gets complicated when Savoy, the wife's president, catches the eye of Don Luis, falls in love with her, singing the national song and a dance form, Jota Te Quiero Moreno, a love song to Savoy. Please welcome my friend, Mario Ruiz.
Thank you.
21st, 1879, in Alhama de Aragon, began his studies in the School of Music in Zaragoza. A talented violinist, he became the leader of the Teatro Circo at age 20. After becoming the conductor in the Teatro Circo, he was offered a job as a lead violinist at the Teatro de la Zarzuela in 1905. It was here that he was able to develop his love of the theater. His zarzuela, El Niño Judío, the Jewish Boy, is a zarzuela in two acts that premiered in the Teatro Apollo on February 5th, 1911, libretto by Antonio Paseo and Enrique García Álvarez. Act 1, Scene 2 starts at the palace of Hamir Halina in India, where warriors and dancers are praising the king. However, the prince is sad at the loss of his first wife, and whom extends a courtesy to a poor family, allowing them to stay in their homeland after they have angered his second wife, and she sends them off to exile. At which Concha, the sweetheart of the book stall keeper, sings to the prince about their homeland in a canción española, a Spanish song. De España vengo, soy española.
Thank you.
embodied the latest flowering of zarzuela. He was born on March 3rd, 1881, the son of a well-known organist in Madrid, Gorova, gifted in composition, conducting, writing, symphonic, and instrumental music, is known for his symphonic works rather than his stage work. He premiered his first zarzuela in 1920, but it was La famous La Marchanera, The Girl from Marchena, in three acts, libretto by Fernando Luque, that premiered in 1928, that pushed him to newfound fame, and is considered one of the most colorful scores of the time. It is set during the time of a revolutionary turmoil in 1840, Andalusia. A plot revolves around the classic love triangle between Don Juan and two women in love with him. The two women are Paloma, la Marchanera, and Valentina. Valentina, who is an aristocrat daughter of a count, and she disguises herself as a gypsy singer to win the heart of Don Juan with her haunting pretanera, Tres Horas Antes del Día, a traditional flamenco song considered to be unlucky.